Welcome to Professor's Corner. I'm joined with Melissa. We're having a continuing conversation in applied ethics and public policy. We've been focusing a lot on normative ethics. We've looked at some very popular theories. Now we want to try to think about what from this can we take as evangelicals. I'm not going to promise a full theory here. These are some of my ideas that I'm pulling together. And you, as policy specialists, will have to figure this out in your careers. I don't think there's one single answer in terms of a methodological approach to addressing public policy, but I hope that this will help you get a start on sort of the contours. So we're calling this theological non-consequentialism. Mm-hmm. I think it's pretty obvious what I'm after there. I want to have God in the picture, the Bible in the picture, and I don't want to be dictated by consequences, but I recognize the importance of consequences. Secondly, a subtitle is The Contours and Approach of Public Policy in Secular Liberal Society. If you'll think back to our sessions where we've tried to talk about the idea of Christianity and liberal society, that's what I have in mind here. We want objective morality. We want to preserve liberty and freedom. We're not theocrates. We're not forcing people to live on the Bible, but we're simply bringing that into play within the context of the overall debate, because we believe that there's truth to be conveyed through that revelation.
What do you think might be, I like this term, this theological non-consequentialism, because it does help me see God being involved, and we're not going to be utilitarians at the mm-hmm. same time or just based on results. What do you think might be some attractions of this hybrid that's bringing some different ideas together?
Okay, I'm going to abbreviate non-theological consequentialism is TNC.
How about that?
So I think that TNC explains how morality can possibly be objective,
right?
And why moral standards depend on something other than human opinion,
right?
That is objective in that sense. I think that TNC coherently explains why morality is specially suited for human beings.
Yes.
Based on biblical understanding of human needs,
right?
That meeting these needs give rise to obligations. So I think that TNC has a clear account of the origins of morality. That
yes.
is that we get content from revelation. Experience as well, but our morality rests upon theological foundations. I think also that TNC considers consequences from actions, but unlike the utilitarians,
right.
we are not hamstrung by that. It doesn't define our theory.
Right. I know that for Christians, we do want to consider our motives and our intentions. So in that way, we're Kantian.
That is true. And that in that way, we're non-consequentialists.
Why do you think that we're bound as Christians? Or what would be some reasons biblically that we're bound to consider our motives and intentions?
Well, I think that the Bible in 2 Corinthians 10:5 or 1 Peter 1:13, it talks about, you know, pursuing goodness.
Yeah.
Those ideas are deontological, or they're motive driven. Our motives should be serving the Lord, but in a particular way, seeking kindness, seeking justice. Those are all intentional acts. They're things we do irrespective of the context or the consequences. So in that sense, I see in Scripture that, I mean, we have a lot of sources. We have divine command, which is law-like deontology. We have virtue ethic.
Right.
And I'm pulling from those resources into this context.
At the same time that we value motives and intentions, I think as a Christian, we do also want to take into account consequences to a certain
We do.
Degree.
And when we do, we have to rationalize that in some way. That is to say, maybe this way to say, every action is going to have multiple consequences. Think
yeah.
of any action you've ever taken. And
sure.
this is a great exercise for students to think about any time, take a paper and pencil, sit down, write out an action that you took today.
Yeah.
And then under that say, this could have been either consequences that did happen
right.
or these are, could have happened if I would act differently. And you're
right.
going to see that there is either acts that overtly occur or those that implicitly could have occurred that still count. And so what that means is we need a way to think about consequences, particularly those that come about harm. And there's two ways historically that this has come about, and I'm adopting them here. They're actually natural law theory. Thomas Aquinas talked about these. And the first is the doctrine of double effect.
Okay.
And the other is we're basically saying we may foresee bad effects, but right. we don't intend the bad effects.
Right.
So we have to be able to explain that credibly. And then with that is we make an ordinary distinction in our ordinary intuition between acts of commission, things we explicitly do, and things that we could prevent.
Okay.
We tend to attach greater significance to the avoidance of doing harm.
Yes.
At the same time, we don't feel quite as strongly about preventing harm
right.
in all cases from occurring, right?
Right?
Now, the utilitarian wants none of these distinctions,
right.
incidentally, obviously, because they're trying to rule out motive. If these distinctions hold, we'll look at them a little bit more here in a moment. If they hold, then consequentialism is false.
Okay.
Let's take a look at the first of this is the doctrine of double effect. Again, these are consequences that are foreseeable, but they're not intended.
Right.
All right? The principle of double effect holds that such actions should be performed only if the intention is to bring about a good effect.
Right.
And that the bad effect will be an unintended or indirect consequence.
Right.
And more specifically, it has to meet these four conditions.
Okay.
So the action itself must be morally indifferent or morally good.
Okay.
Okay. When I go to war, my intention isn't to kill people. My
right.
intention is to save the nation.
Yes.
A bad act or a bad effect must not be the means by which the good effect is received. Think of the movie Crimson Tide, where Denzel Washington, the XO, is in the controls,
right.
and they've been hit by a torpedo,
yes.
and he's got people down in the bilge, and you got 2,500 people on the submarine, and
right.
they're going down, and they're gonna crash.
Yes.
And he has to give the order to kill the bilbage.
Mm-hmm.
Now, he didn't give that order because he thought that those people down there were running a political agenda to run mutiny against him.
Right.
Right. And siding with the commander on the ship, they were trying to save life. So he was trying to save the 2,500 life. That's the
right.
goodness.
Yes.
The side effect. The unintended is their life is going to be taken. He did everything possible
right.
to get them out of the bilbage.
Right.
Okay.
But ultimately, it didn't happen exactly as he may have hoped, but his hope was right.
His hope is right.
Saying.
So there was he didn't intend a bad means
right.
To get to the good outcome.
Right.
It was foreseeable.
Right.
The third is that the motive must be achievable. The motive must be the achievement of a good effect only.
Right.
Okay?
Yes.
So... I'm trying to save lives.
Right.
And then finally, four is the proportionality. The good effect must be at least equivalent in importance to the bad effect.
Okay.
Right? So...
You wouldn't want the good effect to be so slim that the bad effect... In a small way here, it does sound a little bit like we're bringing in some of the utilitarian
well,
ideas.
Again...
It is greatest good for
well,
great... Not,
well, but
we're not... How do we judge the greatest good? It may not be quite the same way as a Christian.
Excellent point. I'm thinking the folks listening in are thinking the same thing. But here again, this is we're taking motive as a consideration in our overall calculation.
Right.
The outcome of this isn't going to determine. It becomes the way we form the evidence of one piece among many.
Right.
That's what's going on.
Okay.
That's why this. It looks consequential is because we are still factoring in.
Right.
But if this holds and I can do this, here's the utilitarian doesn't care whether you intend a bad act to produce a good effect.
Right.
The means justifies the end, or the ends justifies the means.
Yes.
This says that the ends never justifies the means. The ends
right.
always has to be good. That's a major difference.
Right.
So that we're talking about consequences and it looks like we're being confused with consequentialism, we are not.
Right. It's a little, there's a nuance.
We're assessing the motive associated with a variety of consequences that follow. Let's look at another one briefly.
Yeah.
Omission and commission. A commission, we tend to attach great significance to. We don't want to commit a bad act, right?
Doing it intentionally, right?
But prevention or omitting, you know, or allowing, that's another issue altogether.
Right. As a Christian, we care about both because there are times, for example, where individuals take racial injustices, for example, that might have been an act of omission where you just didn't step in where you could
mm-hmm.
have.
Mm-hmm.
And Christians will feel like a sometimes and need to repent for not stepping in when they should have. And it doesn't have to be a racial injustice. It could be something else.
Right.
I'm just bringing that up. But as a Christian, it seems like we carry some weight for both of these.
All right. So let me just say that what I'm describing here is what our natural ordinary tuitions are.
Right.
Right. And in that, I think we would place greater significance on harm, preventing harm, as opposed to preventing, significance to doing harm as opposed to preventing harm. Now, what you've brought in is revelation and more content from revelation that might adjust to the degree which we have an obligation in prevention.
Right.
Right. Now, if we had more time, we would work through a series of examples and we'd see how far you want to go with that.
Right.
But the point is you're making is you're bringing in Christian content, and that's exactly what we want to be able to do. That's the theological non-consequentialism. So, yeah, as Christians, we might look at a situation and say, this is something we could, this is a harm we could reasonably prevent, and we should. We shouldn't ignore it just because, you know, we typically don't worry much about preventing harms, just the doing of harms.
Great.
So we're not totally off the hook here from preventing harm.
Right.
But where do we decide that? Where do we get the content? That's coming from biblical revelation.
How do we think about moral facts as a Christian? I
mean, well, the first thing that we do and the big idea is we don't buy into the separation of fact value.
Got it. So we're not going to get into this rationalist school that's put so much emphasis on, and but at the same time, we're not going to push into the romantic school where we're going to put more emphasis on emotion. Right.
We're not going to be the empiricist. We're not going to be the relativist. And so when we're looking at human needs and I think those are, we can learn those through science.
Yes.
But we're going to interpret what a need is. Again, from our Christian worldview.
Christian, yes.
So moral facts are science facts, just scientific facts, are not just scientific facts about human nature.
Right.
I actually, in my slide, I need to make a change there, Melissa, because
moral facts are
not just
scientific facts. They're more significant than that.
So that's all I'm trying to get out here, and that we don't separate fact and value. Now, that's not to say we don't filter and think about the values associated with facts. Clearly, we have a critical ethic that's Christian.
No.
And in my view, as a philosopher, it's going to be a natural theology involved in that as well. But okay.
What happens with our principles? Because I don't think that we're fully a principlist, even though we like some of the ideas of Beecham and Ross.
Yeah.
But how does that play into our?
Well, I think first of all, we want to understand what we mean when we use absolute. It's in the sense of grounded in a transcendent being, not. This idea of absolute being exceptionalist is an enlightened morality that comes out of the 18th, 19th century. And somehow Christians feel like we don't have a universal law unless we've got that. We need to remember that absolute principles are absolute in the sense they're grounded in an absolute being.
Right.
Not in an absolute human rule, that a rule that humans create that we can never take exception to.
Yes.
So we make a distinction on the word absolute to begin with. Secondly, we have multiple principles. We're not a monist system.
Right. We have many that.
And our principles are universal in the sense that they're general.
Right.
Principles can come into play. That's the kind of the Rossian notion. But I think we find that all the way in Scripture. They're not this universal exception. This is an Enlightenment strict rationalist position that I don't think Christians are, and I don't think, frankly, secular people like that aspect of the Kantian system either. And finally, they're prima facie, obviously, they're indeterminate.
Right.
They have authority in the sphere in which they operate, but they can't come and conflict, and they're indeterminate.
And I know that Christians, we've kind of already talked about this idea that for Christians, liberty is important, but the liberty is because we're created by a divine being, and that's why that matters. But we also have to take into account truths that we know and limits that we have.
So what I have in mind here is, you remember in the debate over rival conceptions of liberal society, the world we live in has given up on truth because they think that objective truth is oppressive.
Right.
I want to say in Scripture that it teaches that truth and liberty, we have our freedom because we stay with truth. right? That is, we stay with truth, we'll have the maximum amount of liberty that we can have in society. I think that's what John is getting at when he brings forth the words of Christ. Know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Mm-hmm. Or Paul says, now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit is of the Lord is, there is freedom.
Yes.
This idea that it is truth that gives us freedom.
Right.
Right. But unlike the utilitarians, while we're strongly committed to truth, what we find intrinsic value in is the dignity of the individual. But unlike Kant and contemporary people, the intrinsic value that we have is of individual freedom in the individual is because of the relationship they have with God, and that God has given us all an eternal destiny.
Right.
And that is the surest way. And we can't abrogate that, so we can't jump in. We have to have principles for why we can intervene in people's liberty. And that's why, even though we disagree with them, people have a right of conscience to pursue what they know is good.
Yes.
But we don't just not automatically interfere with somebody that is pursuing something that they know is wrong.
Right.
Right?
Right.
That's a big difference.
It's
also within Christianity, because there are some folks that think, hey, we have to purge anything that's a wrong act.
It's a wrong act.
And what I'm saying is, we can live in Christian liberty as long as we can debate the issues.
Is that kind of how Christianity and liberal society can interact?
Yeah.
That we've got to be able to talk about these topics,
and I think
maybe
that's
how
the way I'm talking
fit together.
The way I'm talking about Christian ethics here is it's a very reasonable, reason-based type of thing. It's things that people can understand, even though I'm bringing revelation into bear in the topic.
Right.
So we've kind of already hit on the idea of Christian and liberal society.
Yeah.
I just wanted to make a couple of points here. And then we'll conclude with this, is that liberalism bases itself on a conviction about the nature and destiny of human beings.
Yeah.
And where a fundamental human need is of individual freedom to choose that way of life to live.
Right.
And this conception is understood as having an explicit metaphysical framework.
Yes.
I get this from Basil Mitchell. The other point is that one is not truly free to follow the injunctions of their conscience to pursue what they think to be right without at the same time being able to do what they know to be wrong. But that doesn't mean that we accept the wrong.
Right.
It just is, you have the ability in a free society to do it, but we still can judge it morally. Does that make sense?
Yes, that makes sense.
And so yet to prescribe the interference, as I've just indicated, because the action is believed on good evidence to be pernicious, it's not turning a blind eye to moral error. And this is where the problem is. We look at on the university campus and we see people doing certain things and we judge it and they go, oh, I need my safe space.
Right.
They're trying to insulate themselves not only from the law,
but from
moral debate and argument.
Right.
Without the law.
Right.
You see what I'm saying?
Yes.
This is a huge thing,
a big
difference. So in the end, our guiding principles are we have to tolerate maximum individual freedom that's consistent with the integrity of society. We have privacy is to be respected as far as possible, and that public policy is concerned at least with the least intrusive standard rather than the maximal standard behavior.
Okay.
All right.
And I know we can't solve this today, but we've at least unpacked it a little bit.
Thanks.
Okay.